Hello, our beloved believers in Christ. Thank you for joining us on this wonderful program that we bring to you weekly live from our studios here at LLBN. Well, today we're so happy to introduce to you a special friend who's also a fellow believer and a great institution who chose to be part of supporting LLBN outreach. I'll have Marlon introduce our guest for us. Marlon?
Well, Curtis Anderson, you're with Upper Columbia Academy, been a great friend of LLBN, going to become a greater friender because you're going to come back more than just every couple of years.
I hope so.
Yeah. Tell us about these kids.
They're just great kids. We've spent the last 5 days together. We still like each other. That's pretty amazing.
That is amazing.
That is amazing. I could take them anywhere. And we go to a restaurant or out to eat, and people come up afterwards and go, "Where did you find these kids?" And I said, "Well, I have a whole school full of them." Mm. So truly amazing kids, very talented, love to sing for Jesus.
How many kids are at the academy?
About 230 right now. So it fluctuates as these things do, but about 230 kids.
Kind of a nice size.
Good size.
So
one of our largest, largest Seventh-day Adventist schools.
Yeah.
It has been, I think it still is the largest boarding school in America. Hmm. So
we have 8 representatives here in the Octet.
Yes.
Who are they?
My first soprano is Asia Brazil Gishik, a senior from Idaho. My second soprano is Molly Ahola. She lives right there in Spokane area. Mm-hmm. My first alto is Carly Hager, lives in Brewster, Washington, 3 hours away, I would guess. My second alto is Missy Serdahl, lives right there in Spokane. My first tenor is Alan Stafford from Yakima, Washington. Senior. My second tenor is Ryan Smith from Walla Walla, Washington. He actually spent some years living in our community, but his family moved to Walla Walla and he went with them, but he came back to sing, and I'm delighted that he did. Raleigh Petty is our baritone, and he's from someplace in Montana. We'll just leave it at that. It's not a suburb of anywhere. And then our bass is Owen Millage, who lives up. He's actually was born in Loma Linda, or this area, and his mother lives up in the, northern Washington someplace. So I don't know exactly. He could tell you, but I don't know, and he's a senior. And then our piano player is Hannah Chilson, and she's from Reno, Nevada. She's a senior.
Wow, all over the place.
Yep, we get them from everywhere.
So this is a really special relationship with these kids and their ministry. What would you add to that?
Well, I love the bonding between Curtis and the students. Obviously, this is a truly faith-based organization, because 2 years ago we had you here. We heard incredible stories and how everyone worked together for the greater cause of serving the Lord. But with all sincerity, I'm saying this now, but also I think the school has even reflected their faith by the fact that they are helping our ministry. They are a sponsor of LLBN, so we can continue to share the good news of Jesus around the world. And that's direct reflections of the faith of your school. And I'm grateful for that. It means a lot to us to continue preaching the gospel of Jesus, and having that relationship, it even increases my admiration for your school, and I'm sure the admiration of our viewers, to know that every school has limited budget and every school try to meet things according to the budget, and here you are supporting our outreach. Big thank you. But not only for that, you also brought all your students or your students with you here to bless our viewers with music that we will use for years to come. And that's just an added bonus to that support you are given to LLBN. So thank you to you and your wonderful, talented students.
You're welcome.
And to the leadership of your school.
You're welcome.
Well, I think before we go any further, I think we have a good video will tell us even more in depth about Upper Columbia Academy. So why don't we take that break, Marlon, and watch the video, and then we'll come back to continue our conversation.
Sounds like a good plan.
All right, let's watch that video.
I see God moving in UCA, in the students, in the faculty, in the people that come here, because when they see what we're about, they're changed too. As we're growing as brothers and sisters in Christ, He will transform us from the inside out to be disciples for Him and to lead others to Him and see who He really is.
And a lot of us think that maybe we've gone too far with things in our life. Maybe He won't take us back. Each and every one of you are accepted.
Because the cracks and the crevices and the shattered pieces shed the most light. Then why do we keep walking around every day, internally broken and shattered, but with a fake face on, pretending that everything is perfectly okay? People that don't think that they are significant enough for our God, that is where His light pours through.
I don't know about you, but I don't want to be fake happy. I don't want to have a fake purpose. I don't want to live a fake life.
My favorite part about working at UCA, bar none, is watching Jesus at work in the lives of students.
I was a Seventh-day Adventist. I had gone to church all my life, but I had never really loved God. When I came here, the opportunities just came pouring in, and when I finally got a taste of who Jesus was, I could not get enough of it.
God has used so many instances to bring young people who are hurting and wanting that family environment, and they find it here at UCA, and they feel free to discover who they are.
I think I've opened up a lot more since coming to the school, and I can see it in the people all around campus every single day. Just the God like shining through other people.
I think that's really amazing for people who haven't gotten to have that different kind of look on God. He's not just church. He's in sports. He's in music.
Over my 12 years here, I think probably the biggest thing that makes UCA stand out is balance.
UCA has a wide range of opportunities for students to engage in learning both inside and outside the classroom. This includes our gymnastics program, who goes on tours throughout the year, as well as an exceptional music program. We also have an amazing industrial arts program where students can engage in welding, woodworking, and auto mechanics. We have a student farm, an equestrian program, as well as an internship for all juniors during their junior year.
My favorite part about UCA is probably the staff. They will just do anything to help you succeed, to help you grow, and to help you learn.
They put so much effort into just making you feel like you're important and you matter.
I was in public education for so long that I really learned that you get lost in the crowds.
I never felt like I belonged where I was until I came to UCA.
But I think a big difference is just that people are a lot more welcoming and I feel really included.
Just coming here, it's helped me to open up, break out of my shell, and to start becoming the person that I think God wants me to be.
Sometimes you'll have a student that knows nothing about God, and praise God, they have been introduced to Him at UCA, and you can watch a life change.
This experience, particularly at Upper Columbia Academy, is a slice of life you can never recapture.
This has honestly been one of the best years of my life. I've just grown in so many different ways. I feel like it's prepared me for what God has for me next.
I think that this is really going to impact me for like the rest of my life, and I don't think you can put a price tag on that.
Bottom line, Upper Columbia Academy is more than just a school. We're a family where students can come, they can live together, they can learn together, and they can grow together in Jesus Christ.
Very impressive. Great operation. Marlon.
I loved it.
Yes.
I wish I went to school there.
Well, you can always go back to school if you want to, but let's not do that, Marlon.
No.
All right, so are we ready now for the music?
Yes.
All right, Marlon, should we just step out of the stage and...
Sure, if the stage is yours. You know, bless us with your songs of message and the message in the song.
Thank you. We will do our best.
Thank you, Curtis. God bless you.
For the piano player, so I'm going to be walking over here as we go. The first song, Great Jehovah, a beautiful piece by Pepper Choplin. And the message is, guide me. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah. That's a song you've heard before and absolutely beautiful. We took this song in 2015 to China with that octet that year and performed this all over the continent there. So we hope you enjoy. Great Jehovah.
Thank you.
Our next song will be Open Thou Mine Eyes, a beautiful number written by John Rutter. Open thou mine eyes that I may see. Incline my heart and I shall desire. Order my steps and I shall walk in the ways of thy commandments. It is a prayer asking God to show us how he wants us to live. Our next song is entitled Offertory, written by John Nesbeck, and it asks the questions, what should I bring before God? Does he want my firstborn? Does he want the best of everything I have? No, Micah 6:8 answers it. He has shown the old man what he wants. He wants to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God.
Shown thee what
We're going to change it up a little bit now and have our ladies trio sing a beautiful song by Selah, Wonderful, Merciful Savior, a song just praising our Lord with the beauty of music. So we'll have the guys come off stage right now and the ladies sing their song. What a beautiful piece of music. We're going to switch now, have the ladies leave the stage and the gentlemen come up. I'm sure that most of you, if not all of you, have heard of Wayne Hooper. And of course, we've heard of Wayne Hooper. He has a scholarship at Upper Columbia Academy for brass players. Apparently, he was very much into brass. But we love his music, and the men's quartet is going to sing Old Time Religion.
Time religion, give me that old time religion. and it's good enough for me.
It was good, silence. It was good, silence. It was good, silence. It was good enough for me.
Give me that old-time religion.
Give me that
old-time religion.
Give me that
old-time religion, and it's good enough for me.
It was good for the prophet Daniel. It was good for the prophet Daniel. It was good for the prophet Daniel, and it's good enough for me.
Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion, and it's good enough for me. Makes me love everybody. Makes me love everybody. Makes me love everybody, and it's good enough for me. Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion, and it's good enough for me. It will take us all to heaven. It will take us all to heaven. It will take us all to heaven, and it's good enough for me.
Give me that old-time
religion. Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion,
and it's
good enough for me. It's good enough for me.
I hope you enjoyed that. That was beautiful. We're going to once again switch it up and have the ladies come on stage. And they have one more song by Selah to sing for you. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. And sinners drawn beneath that flood, I can't say the words, lose all their guilty stains. We hope that you enjoy this piece. Our ladies' trio.
Sinners plunged beneath that flood.
We'll invite the gentleman back up on the stage. Our next song will include all of the Octet members again. And the song is Little Innocent Lamb, a spiritual written by Marshall Bartholomew. We sing this quite often for our children's stories when we go and perform at our churches, our local churches. We sing this with the children's. We invite the children up and the choraleers sit on the stage, or the group that's associated with this sit on the stage. We invite the children to sit in between them, and we sing this song, Little Lamb, Little Lamb, Little Innocent Lamb, I'm going to serve God till I die. There is joy, joy, joy. Little Innocent Lamb.
Serve God till I die.
Little lamb, little lamb, little innocent lamb.
Innocent lamb. I'm not gonna serve God till I die.
Hypocrite, hypocrite,
tell me what he do.
I'm not gonna serve God till I die.
Don't talk about me, or don't
talk about you.
I'm not gonna serve God till I die.
Little lamb, little innocent lamb.
I'm not gonna serve God till I die.
Lamb, little lamb, little innocent lamb.
Innocent lamb, I'm not gonna serve God till I die. Devil, he is God, it's the very shoe. I'm not gonna serve God till I die.
Now if you don't mind, he's gonna slip it on you.
I'm not gonna serve God till I die.
Cause there ain't no dying over there.
In that heavenly land. In that heavenly land. In that heavenly land.
No dying over there.
Till I die.
Satan's wall gonna topple and fall.
I'm not gonna serve God till I die.
Little lamb, little innocent lamb.
I'm not gonna serve God till I die.
Little lamb, little innocent lamb.
Innocent lamb, I'm not gonna serve God till I die.
Cause there ain't no dying over there.
In that heavenly land. In that heavenly land. In that heavenly land.
No dying over there.
Joyful song, a great song, and the children love it. They come up, they think they're a part of the group when we sing that at our churches. Our next song, a beautiful song by Renee Clausen, Set Me as a Seal. Set me as a seal upon your heart, as a seal upon your arm, for love is strong as death. Many waters cannot quench love, neither can the floods drown it. Set Me as a Seal by Renee Clausen.
For love is strong.
Beautiful. Our next song is about prayer and how vital it is. Lord, listen to your children praying, written by Ken Miedema. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us grace, send us power. Enjoyed that. Our last song this evening is entitled Irish Blessing, written by Graham Longinger, and it is the old May the Road Rise to Meet You, May the Wind Be Always at Your Back song. That is our prayer for you this evening. We hope that you have a wonderful evening.
Your face and the rain.
you hear these angelical voices? Great music? That takes a lot of preparations, doesn't it?
Yes, it does.
About how many hours do you think you can estimate it took you folks to plan for this recording?
Well, we had Christmas music to learn before Christmas, so 70% of this music was learned after Christmas. At about an hour a day, 45 minutes a day, extra time that they put in the effort to be here. There's a few songs that we learned at the beginning of the year that we added into this, but 70% of them are new songs. I would say 25, 30 hours of time.
Wow. That's true dedication, at least on their behalf, of course, yours as well, and all those who participated in this time. Do you continue to plan event after event, and how many events do you do a year?
We mostly tour in Washington. My principal asked me last year, what would I do if I could have anything I wanted? What would I like to see from my department? And I said, I want to have an octet and a brass quintet and a saxophone quartet and a string quartet that travels a lot, not just from Spangle to Spokane.
Right.
Or to Coeur d'Alene, Idaho, or to Plummer, Idaho, but to Loma Linda, to Russia, right. To wherever we can go, wherever we can work it out. We want this to be a group that travels a lot. So that's kind of where we're headed with this. I want this group to go a lot of places and see a lot of people. These are the experiences that they will never forget.
That's right.
My time in high school was, I don't remember math class. Maybe you do. I didn't. I won't.
I don't want to.
But I remember my tours and singing with my friends.
Yeah, amen. So how do they deal and cope between homework, study, and this? I'm sure it's a careful balance.
There's some complaining going on right now with these 9 kids.
Oh, kids or parents?
Yes.
Yes, okay.
Because they know they have a lot of work to do when they get back. But at the beginning of the year, I said, we're going to go on a lot of tours, and you have to go. And this has to be a priority, and it is to all of them. Right. So, and they love this. They're having a great time.
It shows, actually, in their faces and their demeanor. The question I have is when you did it as a young man, beyond just remembering, it must have had some kind of a profound spiritual experience on you.
Of course.
Faith growth. Talk to us a little bit about that.
There's very little that can impact you as much as singing a song and watching the reaction in the audience, knowing it touched somebody's heart. My wife made me a little sign that's been in the music department. I'm not exactly sure where it is right now, but it says, music is the same as prayer. These are all prayers. Music is as much a part of worship as is prayer. That's what that says. Ellen White said that. Mm. And so that's what I believe. And I've watched over the years us sing a song and the people in the audience are completely touched. There's nothing as powerful as that, to know that you affected somebody else's life with your music.
That's right. So. Marlon?
Well, I think Christ must play a central role because you have unusually well-behaved teenagers to watch over.
Yes, I do.
They are a delight. They are well-skilled and well-suited. What's it like to have the cream of the crop come to you like this?
Well, there's talent everywhere. I think Upper Columbia Academy has had a reputation for good music I remember hearing about it when I was in academy or when I was in college. And I remember hearing their reputation has always been there. Great teachers for a long time and very well supported in the community. The Upper Columbia Conference and the people that live in that conference love UCA, love the music program and support it, as evidenced by us being here. And so kids know that they're going to sing or play an instrument from elementary school, and they're going to try very hard to get to the top wherever they can be and sing their music and play their music. And I'm the beneficiary. I have the best job in the world. I have the best job. I don't know, can't imagine what else I would do. And I'm getting close to retirement. Until the kids don't like me anymore and they don't want me around, I'm going to keep going. This is too much fun.
So how do you infuse Jesus into the daily routine when you're at work?
I think when you start singing some of these songs, it has to be there. And if you're going to sing them the correct way, one of the reasons I teach at a Seventh-day Adventist institution, I could make a lot more money in public school, but I want to sing about Jesus. I want to sing about spiritual things, because that's where the rubber meets the road. That's the real important thing to sing. I go to, every summer, I go to a music reading session where we get all the choral directors from the area together and we read through new music. As I said before, people are struggling to find things to write music about that have any meaning. But when you start singing about Jesus and God and the beauty of the world and the way we should treat each other and those kinds of things, there's always music to sing.
I mean, preparing for concerts and to be on the road, for the kids, it's almost like competing or working their way on like competitive sports. I mean, this is competitive music also. It takes a lot of conditioning. Through that process, do you see transformation into their characters from the day you receive them into your program till the day they exit your program?
Oh, absolutely. You don't become as advanced as some of these kids get by not putting in the time. The truth of the matter is, what I enjoy the most about my job is having these kids in my office talking to me, sharing one-on-one, having them come and talk to me about things. Maybe I could help them. That's the real... I love doing the music.
So you have dual outreach, one to the kids and one to those who you are blessing with the music.
These are my kids.
It's your kids.
These are my kids.
Well said. Well said. Well, the Lord's clearly has called on you for this line of work. You dedicated yourself, your life to it, and it doesn't sound like you're willing to go away unless they don't want you, and I don't see an issue here, obviously. What do you do beside music? What other things that draw you close to God?
I love to garden. I hire myself out in the summertime for about 12 hours a week. I hire myself out to garden for other people, and then I have 30
for other
some,
people. You
yeah,
say? Wow.
And then I
could use some yard work. You okay.
Is that like, you know, turnips and potatoes? And
no, I'm not big into that. My brother is, but I like to do flowers. I have, I think, in the neighborhood of 30 roses. I have. And for people that are very big gardeners, that's just tiny. But 25, 30 daylilies, all kinds of... I just love to be outside working, and that always brings me closer to God.
I was going
to
say, I'm sure you see God in this nature.
Absolutely.
In this creation.
Absolutely.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful. Marlon.
Well, is that the front yard?
Hmm?
Is that the front yard?
That's the whole yard.
Well, isn't it wonderful that the Lord has created us, you know, to praise Him in many ways?
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're interested in being a gardener. Well, that is really the first profession that man had upon this earth. And, you know, we've been set up to take care of things and mm-hmm. to be productive. And, you know, since sin came into this world, our productivity must be Christ-centered, you know, and that's really the story of LLBN. If you think about the staff and the hundreds and literally thousands of volunteers over the years, mm-hmm. wouldn't you say?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And each and every one brought in unique talent and gift to the ministry of LLBN. There was never one too many. There was never wasted talents. The Lord continues to bring His people through this ministry, as He does in your ministry. You touch people with your music. somehow LLBN started with an idea, and then it became, you know, a dream idea, and then became reality. But it kept drawing people, Well, the bottom line, Jesus, who's drawing all those people to his work. And it's just amazing to see how Jesus involved in so many ministries. It isn't just broadcasting, and it isn't just music or academies. He's in hospitals. He is in feeding the hungry and dealing with the abused spouses, and the list just goes on and on and on. But it takes me to a point, Marlon and Curtis, I want to make here, that we all have our calling. Mm-hmm. And every man or woman singularly can make a whole lot of difference by building small faith communities in that area of calling that the Lord blessed us with certain gifts. The broadcasting, the music. There's the missionaries who go out and you know, where doctors go out in the mission field and take care of the less fortunate ones in third world countries. Every man, every woman has an opportunity to make an impact. And if you think of the world we live in, Jesus, 2,000 years later, his impact on humanity is still till this day touching the hearts mm-hmm. and minds and souls of individuals. He set that model for us. Sometimes we fear too much to step forward in faith and do things, but if each one of us step out in faith and believe in the gift that God has given us and act on it, imagine how much of God's work will get done sooner and faster. These young people, they don't know what their future is, but God has a plan for them. Mm-hmm. David didn't know what his future was.
That's right.
But God had plans for him. So we got to have faith, we got to believe, and we got to step forward on the gifts that God has given us. Because sometimes we try to do something else, but it's not meant to be. Mm-hmm. We need to focus on what God has given us and let it shine. I know I had tried so many other gifts that I did not have, and it didn't work out. Finally, I had to go back what God pruned me for, and Marlon for what God pruned him for, and obviously in your career, what God pruned you for to do, and see how it makes a difference in people's lives. Any last words?
Well, I think that our viewers really make the difference here in this ministry.
Huge difference.
As a Lone Wonder Broadcasting Network. There's so many exciting things that are occurring today, including the soon to be announced groundbreaking.
Well, it has been announced. Yeah. It's February 21st at 4 p.m. of year 2020.
Yeah.
So it's coming up fast.
Pacific time, we're going to be broadcasting it live here on the Lone Wonder Broadcasting Network. I think we should thank Curtis Anderson and these great young missionaries of music to the community. Just really a pleasure and a joy. Gannam?
Yeah, and thank you again from the bottom of our hearts for supporting LLBN through your sponsorship to help us continue sharing the good news of Jesus around the world. May God bless you, and we'll see you here next week on Christian Connections.